Okay, so I'll be continuing to the presentation, so to the third and the fifth day. So today on the extended lecture, I will elaborate more into the architecture positioning of the whole theme. Of course, I will be talking about almost the same theme, or which is it's actually a continuing theme. So I think one of the problem that we have all this time, or even the knowledge, the system of the education system that we have now, is that we tend to intensify, or maybe if in Adam Smith's perspective, it's hyper-specialization that is also happening since the education, but it's also and then affecting the professional world. So seems that if say, for instance, I'm sitting here in the World South-South Forum, and then we've been talking a lot about sustainability, and then when I want to present an architecture perspective as an architect in the profession, it's most of the time I will be talking plain architecture that I could also bring that to North-North Forum, and also I can also bring that to say non-sustainable point of view, which I think that's where it caused the first problem, because the logic of the knowledge become not ideological, where it's in a good sense being ideological means you have the specific limits to what you're doing. So instead of having like one research going the one way and then practicing on the other way and then getting paid on another way, it's not ideological in the sense that it will not create a holistic approach to the problem that we have in the world. So we have been developing this method, if you may say, of designing that sometimes we go far beyond the limit of the projects just to understand the project itself, the content and everything. And well, it's ongoing, and I believe it will be so until we decided to retire. So at the very least, we have concluded into, we have summarized it into three different aspects of the artefact and the social fact and the mental fact of the architecture. But I need to bring about the whole picture of the forum, because this is not a separate entity. To it's actually have very much connect, they are very connecting to the previous talks that we did. So these were the points that we've been putting up, the day three static city and day five counter hegemony. Of course, on the way that we developed these talks, that we have to elaborate with what the committee wants and the organizing of all of the lectures, and which we are okay with that. But anyway, in the sense of this kind of thing, it will look as what I said earlier, it's very specialized. So it seems that the day three and the day five will have no connection at all, and day six will have even another distinct lecture. So this is what I'm proposing for today, the day six extended lecture. So we'll be talking about architecture as artefact, social fact and mental fact, and there's going to be several frameworks to explain the ideas. First, the psychoanalysis of star architects, we've done this, but I'm doing it very briefly and not theoretical, because I want it's for a broader audience. So, and then the artefact as an example, and then the next is a framework on the Olympic city, and the sample is the National Stadium in Tokyo and Moscow, but both were hypothetical. Of course, we were involved in the National Stadium of Tokyo tender. It was a very, very long process, and we initially didn't pass the preliminary stage. In the case of Moscow, I will elaborate more, because there was really no project for that, but it has many things to do with the new plan for the Moscow as a city. It will have a very strong connection with the idea of urbanism in Moscow. And the next framework will be the chrono chaos. It's the a theory developed by Rem Koolhaas for in regarding to the architecture and time relation. And it's preliminary, but I think it will be good if we introduce it here. It's the postmodern historic trap. And then the mental fact is that the example will be the Medan Merdeka, which is basically Medan Merdeka is the height of political height of our in capital city in Jakarta in Indonesia. And it will consist of the works that we do for the tenders on National Library, National Museum, and National Gallery of Indonesia. And then out of that, it would seem not relevant, but I would like to elaborate further on the BOP flaw and BOP trap. This hypothesis was actually put forward in last year's Bandung Spirit, but we managed to find few adjustments to it. And it will be better if we reframe that in the sense of with its connection to our previous talk in the forum, and specifically on yesterday's day five forum, because it will then make a very a continuous flow with the next session of discussion, which is Office of Strategic Architecture and its its method on progressive technopreneurship. And then if we have enough time, I will very quickly elaborate on the next three frameworks. But even if we miss that one, it will be okay because it will be a little distant entities. So how do we put all of those together? So of course, publication will go along with the means of the timetable that we've developed for the forum. But just for the purpose of the audience for the extended lecture, you may see it like this. So you may see it in the flow in the day 5, day 6, day 3. So it will make the continuous flow from regional planning to the state companies of Indonesian public enterprises, and then going to the artifact, social fact, mental fact, and then ended with the history of urbanism and the future of urbanism. Okay, let's start. Let's get started. I will go very quickly with this one. So in the early stage of our design process was back, the studio was actually started around 2005-2006. But back then, of course, we need to survive on very small projects, and then we spend most of the time doing paper architecture. But on the course of our research, we found that maybe the best way to understand the design process of architecture is borrowing Sigmund Freud psychoanalysis. So we got the three differences of the mind beside itself, the ego, the it, and the superego. And then in form of architectural design method, you will have the form as in a form in the architecture form and the fantasy. We call it fantasy because it's by all means intangible. You cannot really actually measure beauty, because beauty is have very strong relation to different preferences, so you cannot really measure it. And then it will go with the function and the finance, and the superego will go with forensic and faith. Why forensic? I will elaborate more on that on the chrono chaos hypothesis. But of course, in a complex project, all of these three are combining to each other. So it's also like almost Alfred Adler's theory on on psychology is that what we try to achieve here is that by the means of the dominance of each of these three entities. From this the means of architecture, we have the sample of the architects, which will make us understand more easier to give example of these the architects' works. Santiago Calatrava with his form, and of course Rem Koolhaas or OMA with their function, and Tadao Ando with their more faith forensic elaboration. So of course Tadao Ando is very famous for their museum, so for his museum, so it's like it's very different approach to Rem Koolhaas, who's also had many innovative projects, especially those that are just recently built in China, CCTV DVCC and Shenzhen Stock Exchange. There are some of the examples, and Tadao Ando's recent works was Shanghai Opera House, so, and of course Calatrava. Those three different methods will then serve three different clients, the enterprise, the people in the nation state. They have like very different typological needs for us to react to. So I think it's very important that for us as an architect, we don't imply an ideology in the very shallow form that you only serve one particular clients or you only react into one particular method. So and then next, then hence that's when we got the artefact, social fact and mental fact, as by means of psychoanalytical explanation. Okay, let's move forward with the artefact Surya University. So Surya University has a very long recent milestone, but it was like very long struggle. So this is very much connected to what Darwish had said the other day. One of the very fundamental thing that we need to strive in order to liberate ourselves from hegemony is the technological aspect and its knowledge, and that's very important means, and I do very much agree to that. So that's actually when I first met with him. It was in the intellectual gatherings and everything. But and then we also have many visionaries. Like one example is this Professor Johannes Surya. He's been like very intense into this education, educating the Indonesian people, even cross to the very peripheries of Indonesian borders. So what he did was very amazing. In 1993, he initiated the Olympic theme for Indonesia on physics, and then we achieved the first bronze medal in the same year for the International Physics Olympic, and then gold medal on the 1999, and then he initiated on the Asian Physics Olympic, and 2003 we achieved the first Asian champion and then world champion in 2006. So of course these kids are very bright, so which it makes some point that actually south or north, we can, it is no difference, you know, it's just a matter of methods of education. And then he started the Surya Institute initiation for education service of all part of Indonesia, so that they send teachers to all over of Indonesia. And then 3 years later, the initial research project was begin. It's a high-end research project with almost all types of technology, from nanotechnology, biomolecular, subnuclear, and then also in astro technology, we launched the platform for a mini satellite. And then also there was back then 2009 the early research on 4G telecommunication, and I remember the other one, that's the outstanding one, was the Center for Future Transport, which got something to do with the very sophisticated new means of transportation system, individual transportation system. So starting from 2010, the university, the research center start to approach the Indonesian intellects that are living abroad, especially on the technological aspect. So people, especially coming from the U.S. Ivy Leagues and Britain's Golden Triangles, and then plus the MIT. So we start having a lecturer coming from those Indonesian living and working in those location, and then but he did continue with the very basic one, Surya Institute for Education. So it's a school, secondary, primary to secondary means. And then in 2010 is the college, the first college, and it's based not actually on technology, but it's more on the development of the curriculum and the educational system. And then 2013, that's when the university start to be initiated as a university. So it was quite a period. So while our involvement to Surya University has been starting from 2012, so we enter the national competition for that. And on the 2013, we crowned as the second winner for that. And 2014, I was called upon to be one of the co-director of the project, because the first winner project was considered unfeasible to build. So they took our design, but I left at the same year because there was, I think, the time wasn't right. So there was so many turbulence, which is, that's one, the other thing. It's very hard for us to establish a real good quality kind of education. There are just so many distractions. So, but I also very much into it, you know, and have been waiting for the right moment. So actually around one week before I came to Hong Kong, Professor Yohannes Surya did met me in our place in Bali. He visited us and he requested us to return for the initial project. I will tell a little bit more about that because it's a very important phase of the projects that we need to share this kind of thing. So, and then as for August 1st, I will resume office in the development projects for the as a principal in charge. So how does it goes? Why do we have this interest of a long-term commitment? Why does it really matters for me especially? So on the course of our design, when we do the tender, we weren't really after the form at first, because they had like very specific requests for the projects. And of course, we approach it very differently. We try to build something that is never been there before, but also financially viable, but also it can become a symbol. Because I remember Prof. Surya's speech at the first day of our encounter was, he was saying about being a symbol of us as an Indonesian to move forward towards world class, world stage. So means that the university cannot just simply, you know, as it is by all means. So first, there was involvement of very complex mathematical logic that they asked. So, of course, you might get confused, so I will just go through it. So out of this golden ratio, it's SGR, is the Surya golden ratio. It comes with this matrix of geometries, where it will become ring from 1 to 7 to the 8th. And in our presentation we found a flaw in the equation. So we forwarded that the equation was false actually on the ring 7, and then we create our own revision out of that, so and expand it all the way through the peripheries. I will explain it in picture so it's easier to understand. So we have the building scale for ring 1 to ring 6, and then we also have the master plan scale for the ring 7 to 11. What does it mean? We'll show, I'll show it in the two-dimensional planes. So as you see, this is the ring 1. The equation, if you portray it in drawings, it will look like that. And then it will create a geometrical fractal. So the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and they are very specific. This equation is very, very detailed, and which each in one side of the plane, is actually this side is exactly twice than this side, and it will create a logic that it will connect to each other. Although of course it's by within certain limits. And then so we have the ring of the buildings, and then we have the zones of the program. So at first they wanted us to design the campus, of course, using the logical campus as a huge building or whatever, but we create our own method. So we did went out of the border of the term of reference with you, which we most of the time do with competitions, and had most of the time cost us the winning prize because we don't want to obey the term of references. But since we having like the scale was massive, so we wanted them to be separated and to be in various different rings of concentration, so that we don't have like concentrated buildings. And that's the first thought about programming. And then second, so that we can utilize more about the site. So instead of having a huge hollow outside the peripheries, we would like then to insert the greeneries within the perimetries. So and then we have these four main lecture halls, huge lecture halls, and all the research center, and the rectorate building offices in the middle. So and then we have all the main sub function and the secondary function for that. But so by means of programming, actually we don't design it as a building. So it's actually, if you can see, it's like designing a city or a satellite. So and then since we're building a city, the next most important thing is the transportation scheme. Of course, this is an architectural tender. Nobody asked us to build a transportation scheme, but again, it will not function without the transportation scheme. Out of those three rings, the inner rings, middle ring, and outer rings, we have the transportation scheme for inner rings and the middle ring and expanding to the outer rings. So the inner to the middle ring, it will be like walkable, while the rest are not walkable, so by means of different aspect of transportation. So here were the master plan for that. Of course, we took much more careful attention to the middle to the inner ring. So these are the means of transportation from going. So inner ring is walkable, and then middle ring using a PRT and LRT, and the outer ring by BRT or private car in between. Of course, those were and the university back at that time already have an international pattern for the specific types of PRT, personal rapid transit, and they would like to use it. And this is the configuration for the research center. It's also have something to do with the equation based equation-based method that they would ask, and then we implore. And throughout our exploration, we always do all the detailed studies all the way to the structure, and I will go to there very soon. So this is the first innovation of structure. And then this is the next one, is the rectorate building that was designed for a very different purpose. So okay, this is the systematic programming. So at first there was a question from the committee of the, they want to have two different types of class, the 40 plus, around 40 seats class, and the 300 types of class. So we suggest this kind of class where you have all the 40 by 40 by 40, but you can disintegrate the wall, so it becomes 640 classes or 396 seats classes and 1 304 whole. And then of course, and then the next one is the notion of having ecological means. Because why? Because it's in even without being asked, in the scale of a master planning, you need to create a water reservoir for this, and creating water reservoir is, it's not a hard task, it's a simple task. But the problem is, where do we remove the soil to? So most of the time, the problem with water reservoirs have something to do with the soil waste. So instead of transporting it anywhere, we calculate the need soil to be lifted up, and then we just build a terrace just next to the water reservoir. That's become the foundation of the classroom. So actually, this configuration of classroom was very well calculated. In regarding to the soil waste and regarding to the projection of the students. So it's a growing building. So and then with we have, since we already have a terracing soil to build upon, so we then can have the typical auditorium based class for all of the class without any needs to expend more money. And then also from there we can have the roof that is going to be implemented in photovoltaics. And the other thing is that because it's going to be a secluded inner ring, that so we propose the use of the simple LRT, because one of the research that we've been doing is that for the university to be able to produce their very first LRT, so we can use that. Okay, so these are the outer ring going to the middle ring and then going to the inner ring. Okay. But most of our competitors were stopped in that, the two-dimensional understanding of the architecture dimension. So also in the means of the urbanism, I've talked about it in the other day, is that the outdated theory that we have in urbanism is that we always consider the world as a sphere, but the city as a plane. Why? Because the system of zoning, it doesn't, it never really have any connection with a tri-dimensional dimension. So we propose a different method of approaching the building design, especially the center office design. So of course, first we have this ring number 1 all the way to ring number 6, 7, 8, like before it was said. And then, but we also would like to introduce that as a means of a tri-dimensional sections. So, and then we do an expert structure how to make it happen. So these were the programmatic thing of the dean office and all etc. And then it comes with, so actually it we generated from the two-dimensional equation, and then we create the tri-dimensional equation out of that with a addition of a, if you see this, with the addition of a cap, and I'll explain why there's a cap in there a bit later. Okay, so why do we do that? Because it's like this. It has something to do with the symbolism of the university as a symbol of the great leap forward, if you may say. Because most of the time when you say you want to say advancement, then you will talk about the sophisticated technology of construction. Most people which is not in the construction business would think that the modernist, the latest technology is this kind of building. Well, actually, in terms of construction, this building is very simple. It's just you just use a simple rigid columns, and then you just add wherever it flows. And this is Soho in China, but I think the most sophisticated techniques of building has ever invented today, up to today, is applied in the most expensive building by means of square meters, square cube meters cost in the world, in the history of mankind, which is also in China. So it was this building. Although, of course, back if you say in the form, I'm not really a fan of a form of architecture, so a form could be anything, but not many people understand the all of the structural means of this building. It actually display power, and I think the building, in despite of the pro and cons, whether it's beautiful or not, of course, then beautiful is something intangible. But by means of structure, it actually displays the most advanced technology we had up to today. And of course, not many media talks about this because they just want more publication rather than this kind of technological perspective. So if you see, this building was designed so sophisticated that the outer skin is withholding the whole structure. So if you see the all different lattice in the building, they're not for a beautiful, they're not as a form purpose, that's a structural means. So the whole thing is integrated and it's into one cocoon of structure. And in the history of mankind, we never do this before. This was the first one, and I don't think we have another one coming in very soon, because it's very expensive. So from the inside, you can see the main geniuses of these buildings. There are two points, I think. First, it was the initial design commission came during the time of the 9/11. So actually, the first term of reference forwarded by the CCTV was to build a twin tower as an opposition to the World Trade Center twin tower. So it's like a duplication. That was the initial term of reference, but OMA went further than that. So what they do is that they tilt the tower going like this. Why? Because there was a security reason, so it not becoming too high. That's the first one. And the second one is a very pragmatic reason to that, and this is the genius thing, because it's a CCTV is of course a TV company. You will need a lot of space that is a wide, not it's like small spaces but stacked together. No, because of this kind of tilting, they have on this floor very large area for the studio to be into, and it's actually airborne, which makes the all and the structural means of that. So you can have this large area airborne. So, but of course, we weren't the type of too dreaming, visionaries, and we're very much into the account of the financial thing and everything. So we actually did some experimentation and how to make it cheaper. So this is the experimentation that we did. So this is the model. It's a structural model, so it doesn't look that beautiful, but this is a half model. So one side of the model is showing the form of it, the other side of the model is showing the structure. There's a structure. So instead of having the structure connected into built upon its skin, which makes it very expensive, we make the simple ordinary ways of making the structure still in the middle. So that's the main structure. But the problem is that we want to expand it using the Surya Golden Ratio. And how to do that is that we create this lattice, so this is the structural core that holding it. And then we create the lattice that will connect the structure. So if you see, the lattice is connecting the structure and they are supporting each other. So it will become very much cheaper than the typologies that if we are to imply these CCTV models. But at what cost? It has a cost to do this kind of innovation or this kind of efficiency in structure. And then you will have all of this lattice going inside the interior of the buildings. But then we emphasize it to the client that this is to show some strength of the building. You know, it's a strength. Or if I may use Pedro's word, was to give a dignity to the building. It's okay if it's a functional means. It distracts you a bit. It's okay. And actually, this is the CCTV building, one of the inside of the physical building. And then we explain to the client, if you have this kind of building and you impose the dignity, and then you can go head to head with the best technological school in the world, which any several best, because this like the MIT, they employ like the latest building techniques in their campus. So that's one of the reason. So and then we can also explore a new means of architecture, because you have so plenty social space underneath the building, which you usually don't have. So, but then there was a question during the presentation. So why did you put the cap on? Because it's not part of the golden ratio. And then we said like this, you have to put it on. Otherwise, we won't do the project. Why? Because it's essential. That little cap makes the cultural connection that we need with the identity of the nation or the culture. Why? Because it's, of course, Indonesia is very diverse. It's very hard to create one conceptual entity of what is Indonesian architecture. I don't think it's possible to do that. But all Indonesian architecture have a traditional architecture by means of tradition or vernacularity always have a cap. And that simple cap, instead of having no cap, will make the big difference that to create the connection between the great leap forward that we are trying to make and the identity that we have in the past, which of course it's very debatable whether the cap is to make that big importance or not, but at least we try to make the connection. Okay, so this was the initial project submissions. So this is the plan of the buildings. The plan of the campus. And the plan, see, this is what I said earlier. By expanding the campus, you can utilize the greeneries inside the campus. And we use all these different kind of a reservoir, even if it wasn't requested. But and then we, of course, after I was invited to join the development team, we do very elaborate studies on the financing and all this sum and sort, and which is basically even the structural engineer and the finance guy that involved said that our typical new structure saves a lot of money, but it still come at a price that is very pricey. But it's, of course, it's a long-term project, but it's still a bit too expensive for the whole project. It will cost around 1.9 trillion rupiah, but the initial one will cost, the first one, around 700 billion. But for achieving that kind of goals, it's necessary. So anyway, so because there was some dispute, and then I left the office, and then but we also independently helping them in raising the money, because back then I never believed that the education as a system is a means of a profit organization. So I told them, there's no way that you can build a campus, and you don't have to. It's just like this. The paradox is like this. If you want to build just a simple campus, you don't need to do a national tender. Just go to any architect. So if you want to do it with the national tender and you want it not, it's to be special, it will cost a lot. Even after we make so many savings, it still costs a lot. So you have to think differently. It's that post-capital thing that I was thinking back then. So and then we help another parties to look for the financing, and then we came to several companies, multinational companies, and we tried to subsidize. So this is one of the final presentation that we did for a particular company. That the company was calculating their research means, and then because the company is already established green energy company, and by all means that they're trying to make a business out of the green economy, that so that if they can. At that time, one of the initial draft contract was for them to finance the main building only. So introduce the logic of the campus first. Because it's a preliminary conceptual thing, so we haven't got the time to do a proper rendering for this. So the student will enter the class from the LRT. That was the main idea. So the class was talking about. So this was the interchange hub. The transportation mode itself, supposed to be manufactured by ourselves. So this is when we are entering into the inner ring. So by doing this kind of experimentation, different type of experimentation, we are striving to find a new typology of architecture, so, or so to speak. The research center. And moving out to the outer ring. Okay, so but how does it goes with the company that's supposed to fund the central area? So we also designed a research center for them because this is a quite big company. But the research center will also employ a different types of programs. So although from outside it looks very boring serial cloning kind of stuff, it actually different in the inside. It's each of the side of the building was different. So and then this was supposed to be the lecturer quarters, where we actually try to do some experimentation because the land is owned by the both company and university. So whoever live there don't have the rights to own it. So we force them to interact to each other. That's why hence we don't have this typical cubicle plot of the land. And then of course one of the part of the finance is coming from the technopark, because that's when Prof. Surya is actually going around the world looking for partners to develop them, because of a part outside of the, of course this is just a conceptual, it's got nothing to do with the projects, but we need to establish a connection with apart from the big names of the university that I've mentioned before, but also to the industry, and specifically some of the industry that's already familiar to some of the Indonesians. So these are the cities. This was already presented in the other day, but it's part of the presentation that we made on the project. So this was a means of the change. Again, we're talking about the land use. Once if it's developed by one big entity, then we can by means create a different approach rather than using the same method of Garden City or wherever the past has offered us. And so as you can see, we're creating not a city with a garden, but a city with jungle. So it's gonna be like a different types of smart city. So okay, so that was the dream. I would say it's a dream. It's a long dream. It's a daring dream. I'm not really a type of dreamy person, but we did it anyway. So actually there was a roadshow that going everywhere to Google, to NASA, and especially to Boeing, because there's a lot of Indonesian technicians and engineers working in Boeing. But that was the idea. So and then when we were supposed to resume the office, we came to this great advancement. One of the reasons why I accept the offer was that it actually going somewhere, and the project is not now, it's not really just a pure dream, because we start to understand how to do it. So it's very simple. It's in terms of economy. It's you have to need a substitute economy for something that is non-profit. The university is of course non-profit, but we can build a city out of that. So you have to use our real estate, simple real estate logics, so that when we calculate the profit out of the business side of the business, it's very much viable. So we're calculating the profit out of a real estate industry that becomes viable, because we're talking about bubble and everything, and so we can start plotting the profit. So And then in the end of the day, when last week we had the first meeting after my departure 2 years before, the client had convinced us that they actually already found the funding for this project in this very viable business cycle sense. And what other thing that I also surprised was that the funding coming from again China. So I had like now several projects is funding from China, but again in the sense of the circulation of the wealth in the region, I very much agree to doing this kind of thing together between the Indonesia and China. So I agreed to it directly. So let us proceed to the second entity, the social fact, Olympicity. So Olympicity is basically our critics to the Olympic Stadium. Just to give a historical background of that is that I'm not talking about the ancient Olympic, but also there was of course a connection between the Bretton Woods, IMF, World Bank, and even the UN and WTO connection, supposedly with the International Olympic Committee. But I'm not really interested in talking about the politics of it. But in another sense, the Olympic Games or any other games is characterizing our civilization. So hence, if we thought that our civilization is sick, we need to take measures upon all those different things that all of this time we thought it's okay, or so we should to take a careful measures over it. So what is the problem? So first, of course, on the Olympic Games, officially we're talking about the modern Olympic Games from Athens 1896 all the way to the supposedly today's Olympic, the this year's Olympic, the Rio 2016. There had been 26 editions of the modern Summer Olympic Games. Now, I have to make a notion that why do I focus on the summer only? Because the Winter Olympic Games is actually attended only about a quarter to a fifth of the initial Summer Olympic Games. So I want to focus on the of the much larger area of the games. So, but again, we can also make a further focus on the post-war modern era. So it's meaning that only the 18 editions of the Olympic Games. Why? Because I want to find a connection with the South-South Forum that we have been talking about. So from there, I came with quite several surprising data. Of course, the initial research was done for the Tokyo Olympic Stadium, so it had been going several years back. So, but anyway, it doesn't really make that big difference in the moment. So, say like this. Each of the games requires at least 17 permanent stadiums, or equivalent to 306 stadiums. So you see, the Olympic stadiums are huge, and it's very expensive to maintain. And 306 stadiums is a big numbers. So this is not including the older Olympic games, the Winter Olympics, the FIFA World Cup, and other World Cups, because of course, the larger one will be the FIFA World Cup, because you can get simply, you need like 16 in one edition of FIFA World Cup. So you can imagine. What I'm trying to portray is that when we say that capitalism lead us to a wrong way of a means of way of life, then you need also to consider these little things. This is actually a portray of a collective consumption. We have like a culture of consumption that is immersed. So it's like this. If you stop burning the tree, and then you stop using the car, so that it doesn't mean that you're going to stop the global warming or the ecological catastrophic, because there are two logic that we can explain to what really happens now to the ecological collapse of the planet. First, if you by all means refer to the overproduction of the economy, creating lots of waste, that's one way to look at it, yes. But also there's another side of it, the not so popular side, which is actually we, the human being, are over, we're facing an overconsumption kind of a way of life. So our way, there's something wrong with our way of life that created that overconsumption culture. Hence, because the problem is like this, if we haven't have the culture of consuming so much, then we don't have the need to produce so much too. So the work that it again, it doesn't mean that you're living green, then we are being sustainable. So if you living green but you waste so many resources, it's the same thing. So one of the example in the architecture world is the Olympic Games. It's a very basic example of that. So this was the first study that we undergone during that period for the so it's an internal research. So we have this our partners in Asia, Alliance for Sustainable Initiative in Architecture. We have the partners in Kyoto and in Ahmedabad to and us in Jakarta to create like a joint study about the Tokyo proposal. And since there was a initial tender for that, so we also went for the tender. So again, what we strive to do is not the design itself. The design itself, it's important, but it's not going to make big difference right away. So we need to dig little deeper than that. So I will show very quickly some of the, of course this is not done by us. And there had been many incidents. For instance, the Big O of the Montreal Olympic Stadium is the second most expensive stadium ever built. And the Big O wasn't even finished when the Olympics started, because it was like overpriced, so that they have to use the unfinished stadium to help the Olympic. Of course, and then one of the best example for me, that I think, is Munich, because it was like right after the Olympic, it's dismantleable. Okay, and then the next one is of course the story of Athens. So Santiago Calatrava. I will go back to that very quickly. And then the Beijing National Stadium was actually, so there's a trend in China, is that all these big architects came to China utilizing the resources of China to invent new ways by in terms of design. Again, me, I'm personally one of the kind of architect that is very fascinated with the bird nest invention. It never have done before too, same with the case of CCTV. But as it went, the bird nest wasn't is really cost that expensive. It cost only $9 million for a typical Olympic stadium. It's not that expensive, which is good. But the problem with the big nest is the after game maintenance, because it costs so much for the maintenance. Okay, I will just skip them. This is one of the very genius innovation was that the structure is actually crossing each other. So in spite of the fact that it looks like a mess, it actually is very logic repeated structure. So the whole thing is actually repeating itself, but you just can't see it. Okay, so and then we go to London. In many perspectives, we see that the London Olympic was a big success, not only in terms of economy, but also in terms of ecology. Sometimes we got the wrong notion that we can use this kind of games to regenerate the city, income, economy, regional planning, urban planning, and so on and so forth. For example, the London, East London was one of the weakest part of the city, of the Greater London. So they initiated per plan for the Olympic Games was to revitalize the East London. And they had to remove so many citizens. Again, beyond good and evil, I don't know. So but then again, that was also the case of Rio, where they are after the revitalization of the favela, which is very close to the proposed site of the Olympic. So, but in ecological wise, they proposed something that the committee proposed something that never happened before, which is in the terms of tender design tender, they requested a scenario of after Olympics, so that everything has to be able to be either dismantled or downgraded, so that it's not too costly to maintain. So you can see there are so many critics in the architect world with this latest Olympic stadium in terms of beauty. They said it's one of the ugliest Olympic building ever built by mankind. Look at how ugly it is. But for me, it's one of the best Olympic stadium ever built, because it's straightforward, pragmatic, can use more elaborate word, cheap. It can be built very fast, it can be dismantled, it can be downgraded. And the other building, I'm not going to talk about the other buildings. So you can see the point that I made, because why? The next one is we're talking about the Olympic budgeting. Why? Because we're talking about the consumption culture of us. Our human civilization today, you can see the budgeting. Despite of the fact that they are losing or profiting, because it's very hard to calculate whether it's really a lose or a profit, I'm sure. But you can see the numbers. The numbers, look. A nil, a zero. It's a breaking even, but at $14.6 billion. And then let's pay attention to this. So the question is like this: when was it the first turmoil of Greek economy happened? It was around 2006, 2007, 2008, just 2 years after the Olympic Games. So I might say, I'm not going to conclude it that it have a direct connection, but it might have, that actually it was the Olympic Games that causing the country's bankruptcy at the first place. Because at the cost of $9 billion, you could have used the money for something else. And look, 14 to 15 billion loss. So that's another samples of the stupidity of us. Okay. So first we have the consumption, overconsumption, and then we have the overuse of the wealth of the nation for something that we're not sure will be beneficial. Why? Because after the games, what they did was dismantling it. So this was the proposal for the after Olympic. So actually, all of the stadium in the Olympic Park was already designed as such that after the game finished, they could be dismantled. Most of them, and some will stay, but in downgraded scenarios. So the question then is, what's the point? What's the point of having this kind of games? But of course, we have to, as an architect, we have to respond to the game's needs. So what was our proposal initially for Tokyo? This was our initial proposal. It called, the theme was metabolic stadium, meaning that metabolic, as a sense of metabolism, it has a connection with the ability to grow, but also to agglomerate or to deglomerate in the sense of the city, but in the sense of the buildings, either to grow bigger or to grow smaller. But it also has very strong connection to the history of Japanese architecture with the metabolism movement. So what we did was, we conduct a research of the Beijing 2009 and London 2012 and Rio 2016 in terms of what are all the sports had been held in those three Olympics, and then from there we create a similarity chart, as you can see, and then we distinguish several of the white ones, and we took it out of that chart. What are they? For example, the archery, the BMX cycling. This one is canoeing, equestrian. So it's, these are the sports that require specific location. I mean, you don't need stadium for canoeing and everything, you need a lake, not a stadium. So from there we do a specific in detailed study of these, the other colored stadium, and we calculate how much area needed to be used. So, and then we make a classification of the red one, the green one, the blue one, and the yellow one. The red one, we call it the small stadium. The green one is the medium stadium. The blue one is the large one, and the yellow one is the extra large, the athletic stadiums. Like for example, the large one, there's the aquatic stadium, and then the hockey stadium, and then the football stadium, and the track cycling. Well, the small one, you have all of the badminton, boxing, and etc. and etc. So we can create this kind of thing. And then out of this, all different measurement of the fields, we create a system to integrate all of this measurement into a whole system of design. So hence we have a cluster 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 4, and 8, and 1. So how does it react from this to the design perspective? First, before going there, we were proposing to lessen the area of the largest building, the extra large stadium, and then we can do that using not the stadium logic, but we're using the opera logic. So we have an opera instead of a stadium logic. If you put them together, it will become a stacking deck like this. Okay. So, what happened? You can actually put all them together. So, these are the small stadium. These are the medium stadium. These are the large stadium and the extra large in the middle. But when you build them together and interconnect each other, it becomes much more efficient to build. That's the first key. The second key, it becomes also much more efficient in terms of money, in terms of economically. And then third, we can create a new ways of circulation of the people, because this stadium underneath this is empty, so people can cross border underneath the stadium. If you put them together, it become like this. It's like a whole big structure. That's the idea of the Japanese 1960 metabolism movement was about, to create the whole thing in orders in such that it can be efficient enough to be implored. So, but then we also go further than that to the philosophy of the Olympic, is that we introduce the terms, even this kind of thing, even the design of the logo and everything is not included in the initial tender, but we did propose it. We proposed the Tokyo Tomoe, which is Tomoe is a symbol where the symbol of regeneration back in the older Japanese era. So hosting the Olympic Games is like opening an urban Pandora. 1,000 athletes, officials, million tourists, spectators, billion TV viewers and fans all coming and going in 2 weeks' time. So they're coming in 2 weeks' time, and after 2 weeks' time, they're gone. Bringing the games into the urban environment is a risky task. Despite of the development dream, hosting city might even face economic turmoil, dragged into depth of abyss and empty city stadium. Like we've put forward with the case of Athens stadium, with the Greek financial crisis that follows after. And then the Tokyo Tomoe is a whole Olympic park in a single metabolic entity, built on the Tokyo Bay to avoid direct intervention to its existing urban environment, because like when we put forward in the static city day of presentation, Japan is already packed up, the Tokyo network is already packed up with all of these developments. You can't afford to put another big developments within the networks or within the perimeter. So the Tokyo Bay means to avoid direct intervention to its existing urban environment. After the games, the park shall function, transform into a new Olympic city. So from Olympic Park into Olympic City. What does it mean from Olympic Park to Olympic City? Let me show you. Okay, so you have seen this design of the stadium. If you cross over it, you can see people can walk underneath the stadium, right? So this is the big one, this is the small one, this is a little bit bigger one, and these were the Olympic Village if they want to put it together. So as you can see, the design is already compromising all the needs of the stadium within one entity, and they're very specific already. The boxing, the table tennis, all the way to the large, very large one. But following the same logic with the Surya Universe City business substitute, we were proposing for it not to be designed and built as a state-owned project, but to be built as a development of new urban core, which means another real estate project. Why? Because again, urbanization in Japan is inevitable, like in the whole world. And as you can see from the chart that we've presented on the day three presentation, it is ever growing in, even until now. So instead of looking for a new place, we can provide a new place after 2020. But from since its beginning of the construction or this or even the design, all of this stadium has to be designed in such that the concept of the structure is to follow a concept of a city building or a city block. How does that operate? It will operate like this. So by inserting the structure, when it's built, when it's the game is finished, you don't need the stadium anymore. So you have to create this right from the beginning. We already know that it meant to be a city, a new city, the Olympic city. And Olympic city got nothing to do with the Olympic actually, because it's just simply you have a large giant office park, a office block, and a park in the middle. And the Olympic, what do you call it? The village, Olympic village turned into the apartments. And we proposed only to leave four of the large stadium, the football stadium, the aquatic stadium, this one aquatic stadium, and so on and so forth, and convert the rest, like this one becomes a commercial space. So it's almost the same like the static city. And then after 2020 Olympic gone, you have a new city. And basically what you need to, the extra money that you need to build is the conversion. Okay, so, but and then will it still cost a lot to convert? Of course. But we can make the compensation to do that. How? So the nation state, the state of Tokyo, the Tokyo government, the greater Tokyo government, could offer the location for the new Olympic stadium, which is also equals to Olympic city, to the business for free. Then, because it's going to be in the Tokyo Bay anyway, then in terms of business, the development of the whole thing makes sense. But even so, it will cost much cheaper rather than building complex of all different sport activities, and which after the game not going to be very useful. So that's the idea, was that like that. So if you can see, people can actually walk through, passing through the stadiums, because the stadiums are behind, above them. And this is actually, well, of course it's expensive, but it's simple structure. It's not like hypothetically, it's actually much simpler than the Surya University building. Well, as a whole, it won't even look like a stadium. It will look like just a giant structure. But I think what's the most important part of the stadium design was that its use after the game, that it is supposed to create a new space, a new urban space for the city, which initially with additional almost no cost at all. So, but in terms of it's quite interesting. But when we do all the studies, and then suddenly, hey, we never really look at how it looks at from the above. So, and then suddenly one of my employee make this view, and then he said, oh, looks like a lotus. So, but it was never meant to be like that. So it was a result of the design thinking. So everything was actually based on the first. If you see the first chart, why we have all these eight small stadium? Nine actually, because one of the small stadium is two stadium put into together, and then why we have this. But anyway, whatever it is, it is actually serving all the needs of the Olympic Games, because all 17 permanent stadiums are there. So, but of course, we went further than this, because one of the a minus point of our research was, first, of course, there was not enough time to elaborate more into technical means, and then second, we never really get involved in the project because it was a very exclusive project. Sorry. A third, we weren't sure if, because it's basically a city development, it can be done in Japan, yes, can be done in China, yes, but will it be, can we do it in different part of the globe that is not so resourceful? No, because it's a huge development. So we try to then look for another alternative for that. And I was leading the team for the metabolism Olympic in Tokyo. So and then I left because we do some other projects. So it was a case closed for us, Asia. And then our Kyoto partner, Gunter Nishi, with his Institute for East Asian Architecture and Urbanism in Kyoto, went further. So he followed the research, and then he continued with his entity. So it was a writing by Professor Gunter Nishke, was a professor in the for at Princeton, and then he moved to MIT, and then he moved to UCLA, and then he moved to Kyoto. So he is retiring now, but so this is his website, the eastasianarchitecture.org. So this was his paper in 2013, June, after the initiation of the winner of the, which goes to Zaha Hadid, just another great architect, just passed away a few weeks ago actually. So he proposed this critics, Colosseum versus Circus, proposed paradigm shift in the Olympic architecture of 2020. So his thinking was very simple but straightforward, and I saw it implied very strong sense in my mind. He was thinking, why are we building Colosseums after Colosseums? Why don't we instead build Circus? What is Circus? Circus is like you go to one place and you have the circus going, and then after that you dismantle the whole thing, and then you go to the next place. It's not resource wasting things. So you can make it like you try to be playful and make it simple, and he did mention one of the best examples is Munich, which is, I also agree with him. But you know, this kind of tent is very easy to and cheap and everything, and then when the Olympic game finishes, pack up and go to the next. We can have Olympic every year for this, like this kind of thing. So I think his thought was quite surprising for me. It was like, for me, he's in another planet. You know, it was very insightful. So what happened? First, we show you yesterday about the project for regional planning project that brought us to the smelter master planning. One of the initial at that time, two or three years ago, I can't recall. At that time, as we leading the as I was becoming the principal architect, I was scheduled to to fly to Moscow and to have like to accompany the CEO of the project to meet with some investors. And during the networkings, they come across that they interested in some of my hypothetical works, including the Olympic Games, and they tried to connect me with some of the high ranks official in Moscow. And because Moscow is keen to propose another bid in the Olympic, so I said, if it's just only for like a dinner and just a social meeting, it's okay, because we're not talking about anything. I have no problem with sharing all these things, even if, say, someone else copy it, it's okay with me. So but before that, I need to make some notes that both Paris and Moscow had undergone several big changes. They went to do a master plan redevelopment for the whole side of the city. But I suppose with the 2012-2013 world financial crisis, second wave after the 2009 to 2010, I don't know if this still works or not. So this, and I just want to use the retrospective of that year. So this was the winning master plan design for Moscow. So basically, if I'm to generalize the whole thing, they try to expand the city into outer of the city and create a connection, and then in between those expansion, they can insert jungles, gardens, but in a huge size. And they can only do that when they expand the city, becoming like this. So we at back at that time, we only had I think less than a month to prepare something for the government of Moscow in regards to Olympics. And at that time we had no data, and we never designed something without any data. This picture was the only thing that we had. So then there's no way we're going to create a metabolist Olympic stadium like the way we do in Tokyo. But then again, usually this kind of thing is site specific. So we have to go from one extreme of the very large, I repeat the word, Godzilla, to something very small, because now we are having linear spot. We don't want to disturb the big parts. So it's like a challenge for us. At that time, actually, we didn't made it to finish the design, and then even so, we were okay, because the initial meeting was cancelled anyway, just because there was a problem with, I forgot what it was. Oh, it was the Ukrainian crisis. So we didn't go anyway. But recently, just beginning of this year, a specific client, which wish not to be revealed in public, request us to develop this kind of thing. Doesn't have to be for Olympic, it can be for anything, but in the size of Olympic, what can you think about it? So it's a kind of a research methodological thing, so it's not based on project. But and then we took the liberty of the fact that this is a research project, not a real project, to choose Moscow as our case study of location. Of course, it can be changed. So what did we do? So the first thing we did was we went back to the 2012 Olympic Stadium. We made a very, very in-detailed study of the stadium. So we spent a great deal of our resources in here to generate to get all the initial drawings and everything. So this drawing was not given, it was drawn by us. So this is the London stadium that was talked about. So as you can see, it's built upon lattice. It's very simple. Now, if you do a cross section, this is where it get it becoming interesting. You will see. Let's take the left. The structure is simply like this. Chip structure. So this was our standing point where we start our design. From this structural truth. So what did we do? We elaborate the drawings, the design project with the Tokyo Stadium, because by now we already have abundant resource of data about the requirement of all the stadiums. So we are proposing to use exactly the same groupings of small four of nine small stadiums and four medium stadiums, four large stadium and one very large stadium. But now we are using, instead of the metabolism logic, structural logic, we are using the London Stadium logic, structural logic. So it was designed resembling the London Stadium. And we do that for all the stadiums. We made 17 different stadium designs using this same structural logic, but I portray only four of them because those are the typicals. Then the large one, very simple, and the extra large one, very simple. So now, because we are having this kind of independent Olympic stadium, we can insert them in between the locations, here, there, or wherever. We would rely on the urban planner to choose the location. But the point is that we have abundant place now to insert them. So how does it change? How does it, in terms of design, change the perspective on the Olympic? Because it's basically almost like the London Olympic. It doesn't make any big difference, but it does make a big difference. Why? And then we do another innovation. We didn't actually duplicate the structure, but we redeveloped the structure in such that if you take out one of the structure, we can calculate it. For instance, this is the basic structure of the small and medium stadium. And this is supposedly the foundation of the seatings. Now, we can design this from the beginning. So, okay, I will go to the next one. While this one is the structure of the large and then the extra large. So, the initial cost of the Olympic that we proposed was like the circus stadium, so that it's not to be maintained in time after the games. But instead of building cities, because why the Moscow is undergoing such a redevelopment in urban planning, because if you recall from my previous presentation, Moscow is actually taking a hit on degeneration, so deglomeration, so it's sinking. So because it's sinking, they are smartly expanding the location. So it's shrinking in size, but what they do is out of the current size, they disperse it. So hence you have the thing. So you don't need a new center. But from this sense, these two can actually become a building, because they're modular. And we have been designing it as a modular building since the beginning. And all of the structure are identical. From all the 17 different stadiums, all the structure are identical. So it's easy for you to use it for the games, and then after the games dismantle the whole thing, and then you can move it around the city or even move it around the country. And I mean, if you say Russia is basically Moscow and St. Petersburg, and in between Moscow and St. Petersburg, you can create so many buildings out of the leftovers of the 17 stadiums. And we are now still on the phase of calculating the whole thing. How many buildings can we build out of the whole scenario of the 17 stadiums? But the point is that you will not have to first maintain the stadium, empty stadium. Second, you can use it to redistribute the wealth of Moscow into the other part of the country. And you can even make school out of this, or hospital, or whatever. Just as, of course, it's not going to be just like that. There's going to be like initial need for further investment, but that's a start. That's where it starts. So this is what embodied in the design for the Moscow Olympic Stadium was for the wealth to be redistributed from the very center of capital city to capital city center throughout the whole nation.